You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. You've been trying to fill the same old holes inside. There's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. He's a way maker. You need freedom or saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. You've all searched for the light of day, the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know that just ain't right. There's a better life.
His name is Jesus.
There's a better life. If you've got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. You need freedom or saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. You believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. You believe it.
Come on now.
If you receive it. Somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you have pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's the way maker. If you need freedom from saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
If you got pain,
if you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
This morning, third Sunday in a row, we've got a baptism this morning. Please be seated. Woo-hoo. All
right. How are you doing? It's good to see you. It's the third Sunday in a row we're having a baptism here.
Amen.
Amen. Good problem to have. There are times where the water has been so warm we had to throw in ice bags. That is not the case today. It's January and we're baptizing. I do have, it's cold, but I won't be in long and Tony won't be in long. Last week you saw Elizabeth come and was baptized. And today her husband Tony is also coming for baptism. I'm going to talk a little bit, Tony, before you come in because I don't want Jeff standing here real long. Tony gave his heart to Jesus sometime in the past and has already acknowledged to people that he's a Christian. But he's never been water baptized. And so he's following in obedience to Christ today to make that public profession of that inward change of heart. So the meaning of baptism is multiple. There's a few. One, it shows the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. It also shows how, in Romans 6, it shows that we identify with that same thing, that we die with Christ to our old sins, and we are raised to walk in newness of life.
Amen.
That's really
Amen.
What that symbolizes there. And so it shows our new walk with Jesus. And so Jesus said, if you believe in me and the things that I do, he says, if you'll confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father in heaven. And if you deny me before men, then I'll deny you before my Father in heaven as well. He may not have been talking specifically about baptism, but it's a very good way to fulfill that obligation right now to say, I'm here being baptized. There are people being baptized around the world today who are in Muslim countries or countries that is illegal to preach the gospel or to convert anyone, and they are suffering. They take a big chance to be up here because it truly is a public profession of faith. So it's meaningful, means something. It's also a joyous occasion. So why don't you welcome Tony this morning? Come on down. Tony, turn it on for us.
Don't let him slip.
Sorry? Yeah.
Let him slip.
You got it? Yeah. Yeah, so, all right. Tony, do you want to say anything before you're back out here? Say anything to what the Lord's done in your life? He's right. He says, I think my being baptized says it all.
Amen.
Well, Tony, you have accepted Jesus as your Savior?
Yes.
Amen. So you're headed for heaven?
Yes.
All right. So, Tony, upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Bury the likeness of the dead and raise to walk in newness of life. Thank you. Welcome again, Tony.
Praise the Lord. Welcome to Rockettown. What a great and exciting way to start a service with baptism when you see people have chosen to follow Jesus and say, yeah, I've chosen. I woke up to the song this morning, I have decided to follow Jesus. Do you guys know that song?
Yes.
That song was going through my head. I have decided to follow Jesus. The next line, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. And that's what we're seeing this morning. And if you haven't followed the Lord in baptism, if you haven't said, by the way, Jesus did it first. He showed us an example. He said, look, see, I'm being baptized, going through with this, because this is my declaration to you what I am, my focus is here, and that's what we do. So if you would, we're just glad you're here. If you are a first-time guest this morning, we are so excited to have you this morning. Welcome to Rockettown. Welcome to Rockettown Online. We're glad you're here. If you have not gotten a visitor pack, we'd like to give you a visitor pack. Just give us a little wave. Somebody will see you, and they'll bring you a visitor pack. In there is chocolate. You're not a visitor. You just want the chocolate. Anyway, there's also a communication card in that pack, and if you don't mind, fill that out. When we have offering, don't drop anything but that card in there. You don't have to give us an offering, but put a card back in the vessel, and we would like to send you a thank you for coming and worshiping with us this morning. Glad to have you. This morning, we are going to stand for the reading of the Word. Paul Voits is going to bring us the scripture this morning. Paul, come on up. We're using our graduated KV kids now.
Amen.
Yeah, if you want to.
Do I start?
Go ahead.
Okay. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Good job. Amen. Go, Paul. Woohoo. I hear the drain of the baptism back there. It's kind of funny. So, oh, God is good. Father God, Thank you that your word reminds us to rejoice always. Thank you that your word reminds us not to be anxious about anything but to trust you. Thank you, God, that you are our hope in this world, and we give you praise for everything. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Is God good?
Is he good?
Is he almighty? So it's okay to say he's good, God Almighty.
Amen.
Amen. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I'll keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. I can count the times I've called your name so broken night. You showed up and patched me up like you do every time. I get amnesia, I forget that you keep coming around. Ain't no way you'll ever let me down.
Down, down.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good? He's good. Tell me, is he God? He's God. He is good God Almighty. Love goes on forever, that your mercy never stops. So why would I assume you'd be somebody that you're not? Like the sun in the morning, I know you're gonna be there every day. So what on earth would make me be afraid? Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good? He's good. Tell me, is he God? He's God. He is good God Almighty. Tell me, is he good? He's good. Tell me, is he God? He's God. He is good God Almighty. Praise him in the morning. Praise him in the noontime. Praise him when the sun goes down. Love him in the morning. Love him in the noontime. Love him when the sun goes down. Come on, praise him.
Love him in the morning. Praise him in the noontime. Praise him when the sun goes down. Love him in the morning, love him in the noontime, love him when the sun goes down. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs.
Good God Almighty.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs.
Tell me, is he good?
He's good. Tell me, is he God? He's God.
He is good God Almighty.
Tell me, is he good? He's good. Tell me, is he God? He's God.
He is
good God Almighty. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down.
Go ahead, Jess.
How are you guys?
Good.
Awake.
Present.
I started praise God. This past Monday, and I'm done. So, I'm sorry if it came over your back. All right, so what's going on in Rockettown, guys? Our ministries are growing.
Amen.
Yes. It is. You guys are probably laughing at every time I say this, but it's one of the most exciting things to see on paper and physically in the building. So with that, we need more teachers for our Kid Venture. Hey, Kid Venture, can you guys give me a little yell? All of them are back there. Can you guys give me a nice yell?
Quiet.
No? I know y'all are crazy. Okay, whatever.
They're waiting for us back there. They're
waiting. And that was like the one time I ask you to yell. I'm with you. It's fine. Yeah, there's roughly about 20 kids in Conventure right now, and we need teachers. We want to make our classroom smaller so our kids can get a better grasp of what we're teaching them, and so, you know, smaller groups, more personal, more fun. So if you feel led to join us in Kidventure or our cleaning crew or whatever you want to do, please go on Church Connect. There's a QR code on the back of like every other seat where you guys are sitting, and it's also on the corner of your screen if you're watching online. Fill out the form. We'll get you plugged in. We'll rock it, okay?
All right.
Sweet. And next. Awesome. So we have our door hangers coming up. It's going to be Saturday, January 29th from 10 a.m. to noon. Is it still the 29th? I feel like it changed. I'm sorry if it's not the 29th. But it's going to be the 22nd. We're going to do it. It is the 29th. It's the 22nd? I lied. It's not the 29th, it's the 22nd. What we're going to do is we are going to meet here to do door hangers, and then we're going to go help Miss Kate move into her new home. Because we did have a conflict. And we're going to do her neighborhood. We're going to welcome the neighborhood with Kate and then also attack it with love.
Oh, I like it.
So that is the plan. She did. So with that also being said, we also are helping our dear friend Kate move on the 22nd at 10 a.m. She is going to provide pizza for those who come to help. And if you guys would lovely either message the church or her on Facebook, let her know that you're coming. So we have a general idea of how many hands we have helping as well. And she wants to know how much pizza she needs to buy. If you don't know where to go, because, you know, addresses and all that, just come to the church. We're going to carpool from the church to her place or figure out all that fun stuff. So we all can get there at the same time. Sorry, guys. Also, today, after service, is our shepherds and staff meeting. I'm excited for this meeting, just so you guys know. We're planning for the rest of 2022, roughly, events, all that fun stuff. With that being said, for people who aren't going to the meeting because you're non-ministry head or whatever, there is a form on Church Connect where you can also put in your thoughts. It's a form for 2022, and you're going to add what you liked about past events, what you didn't like about them, what events you want to see us do this coming year. I want to see if we can do something for Valentine's Day. I don't know if we're going to, but I want to try. So let us know what you guys are thinking. Fill out that form. If you don't end up coming to that shepherds and staff meeting, we want to hear what you got to say.
Right.
Sweet. Oh, yes. We have our Bible study on Wednesday nights by Pastor Sammy Pollock right here in the front row. It's going to be end times vibes. At all times, that cool, eerie, but really awesome stuff that you need to know. So get excited for that. Bring your friends. It's going to be Wednesday nights at our typical 7 p.m. Starting, February? First Wednesday of February. So that'll be fun. That's cool. All right, that's all I got to say. It's your turn.
Thank you, Jeff. I'm going to borrow that same microphone. Looks like I have a plug in them up here. Is this one of these yours?
No. The other one
all right. Well, normally I'm wearing a headset microphone, but I forgot to put it in and didn't want to kill it in the baptism and
That's really good.
So
good.
I'll try to fumble with holding these. But in this book that my sister-in-law wrote, Inspired Giving, it's got some great teachings every week. And so if you're wondering why do I read this every week, it's because she does a good job of providing these teachings. I just love putting it on here. But it says, here's an attention getter. It says, think of someone you might consider as your enemy. Is there someone you know who dislikes you? They might not have any reason to dislike you, or maybe you just don't like them, or is there someone that you don't like, someone you just can't stand to be in the same room with? Don't start pointing. Okay. When you have a name of the person who that is, it says raise your hand. I'm not going to make you raise your hand, but put that thought in your mind as to who it is or that doesn't like you or that you don't like. The Bible says that you're going to have enemies. We have enemies. Jesus had enemies, and all of us have enemies. Of course, he taught us some things about how to treat them as well, right?
Yes.
And, you know, there's always somebody who really treats you wrong. It says to give a personal example. Sometimes the people who have hurt you the most have been people that actually are in church. So I'm not going to mention any names or anything of people that I've known in the past at other churches or whatever, or in your own life. Nobody wants to have that kind of stuff said out loud. But everybody knows that there are times where people just drive you crazy with wanting to be your enemy or... Yeah, just something about you just makes my skin crawl. Scripture, Luke chapter 6, verses 32 through 36 says, if you love only those who love you, why should you get credit for that? This is Jesus talking.
Wow.
Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get credit? Even sinners do that much. He says, and if you lend money only to those who can repay you, why should you get credit? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for a full return. He says, love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then your reward from heaven will be very great, and you will truly be acting as children of the Most High. For he is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. Now that's underlinable. He is kind to those who are unthankful. You know, people who don't deserve deserve what they're getting. He says, you must be compassionate just as your Father also in heaven is compassionate. As believers in Christ, there are people who will not like you or what you stand for. Their beliefs, their convictions, they may be contrary to yours. But if we see them in need, we are to show love, not just in words, but in deeds. Care for the poor, not just poor Christians. Feed the hungry, not just hungry Christians. This kind of love isn't easy, but what Jesus said represents the God we serve. Amen. Application says, give to someone who doesn't like you that much. That's right. Show kindness to someone who may consider you an enemy. Look and see if they have a need and fill it. This is how we show true love. This idea doesn't come from a church. It comes from the words of Jesus.
Amen.
What an amazing way to show God's love to someone. Find a way to bless an enemy this week and see what happens in that relationship. Watch God turn it around.
Yeah.
So that's a good challenge there. You say, well, what does that have to do with money? Sometimes God wants us to be mindful about, as we learn to be good givers and supporting of the ministries here at the church, sometimes we need to be giving to others as well. We have a benevolence fund here, and our benevolence fund primarily always, we try to keep that to meet the needs of each other. It's one another ministry in the body. And if you start meeting the needs of those who are outside of the body, you'll get a line from here to Gainesville of people ready to take all that you'll give. So that becomes a logistical, we can't do that and serve everyone's needs. So how do we obey Christ then? So how do we do this thing of meeting the needs of others, loving our enemies, those who are not Christians, those who may be Christians but are acting enemy to us? Then we as individuals still have the responsibility to hear the voice of the Lord and to give to others, even the ones that we don't like that much. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, with that said, if you're giving today, you can see there's several ways to give online, including the QR code on the seat in front of you. You can give in the slide card in the lobby. It's the old-fashioned metal, you know, slide your card thing. Don't tap on it. Don't bang. It won't do anything. All right? You gotta slide the card. There is, of course, online. You can go to Rockettown.church and give through the portal there. You can always give cash or checks. Today, April and I are going to be given by check, and there's an offering vessel right in the back between the double doors. And as soon as I stop here, I'm going to send my offering back there. But I'm going to pray a blessing over yours, however you gave this week, whether you've already given, whether you're going to give online, whatever that is, I want to pray a blessing over your offering and ours today. And as soon as I finish, we're going to stand up and we're going to do some more worshiping. And we're going to ask for the elders to come up here and pray for you. Those that are on our ministry team to pray for the sick. And you can come and be prayed for. Right now, Father, we just want to thank you for your goodness to us, how you have blessed us abundantly, how you have met every need that we have. This past year, Lord, as a church, in some of the most trying times in modern history for churches, Lord, you have met every need that we've had. And Lord, there hasn't been a lot left over, but you teaching us, Lord, to give us this day our daily bread. And we thank you for how you continue to answer that prayer. So, Lord, for everyone who's given this week, for everyone who's given today, those who are listening online, Lord, or are in person, Lord, I pray that you would bless their offering today. I pray that it would be that which would cause them to have enough to give and enough to live. Father, would you meet their needs as they honor you in giving? And, Lord, we give our gifts gratefully to a God who is the author of all good things. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Stand if you will, and come on up if you want prayer.
Who am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again? Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you tell me who I am. I am yours. Who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I'm yours.
serve, whom shall I serve? I am yours, I am
this song. I had some help this week choosing some music. Precious young teenager was here this week and she helped me pick out songs. And I didn't realize how prophetic God used her in picking out the songs today, because today Pastor is preaching about worship. And this song, she said it meant something to her, it meant something to her family. And I had this thought this morning. When we're struggling with something, God says, if you will seek my face,
amen.
If you will seek my face, like it's your next breath, like it's your life, he will be found, and he will be everything you need. So as we worship this morning, I want this song to be a prayer from our hearts, where we say, God, I am coming to you. And I am going to seek nothing else. I'm looking at you only. You are my answer for whatever's going on in my life. You are the answer for everything. We live in a very broken world, and we live around very broken people. Some of us may be broken, but we come to the Savior, who is everything. He's our life. He's our comfort. He's our protector. He's our glory. He's the glory and the lifter of our head. That means he literally says, chin up, kid. I gotcha. You're mine. So as we worship this morning, make it from your heart. Don't let the song just go by as a song. Make it a prayer this morning.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came. To the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know.
Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Wonderful to me. Oh, sing a song of praise to him this morning. Just tell him with your own words how precious he is to you. Thank you for life this morning. Thank you for breath in your lungs this morning. Thank you, God, for saving us, God. Thank you for your mercies that are new every morning. Thank you, Jesus, for a people that love, God, that we can worship together. Lord God, thank you for your unending mercy and your love that knows no end. Thank you, God, for waking us up with a beautiful sunrise this morning and for the beautiful rain that falls this afternoon, Lord Jesus. Thank you, God, that you shower us with your love and your mercy and your grace. Thank you for salvation. Thank you that you paid our debt. Our debt. Thank you, God, that you paid our debt. Come on, people, praise
Him. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done.
Lord, your name, Jesus.
You are so good, God.
Lord,
you are so excellent in everything you do. There is none like you. There is no rock like our God. There is no other Savior. There is no other greatness on this planet or in the heavens above. You are everything. And from the bottom of our heart, God, we lift our praise to you. With everything in us, we acknowledge you are King and you are God. There is no time left to waste our lives on other stuff. Jesus is coming soon, very, very soon. And he says, people, be ready. Be ready. Be ready. Be looking, be watching, be putting your face toward heaven, saying, God, am I ready? With fear and trembling and scared out of our minds, God, may we be ready. May we not be playing with the world. May we not be acknowledging our feelings and our wants and our rights. Oh, God, we lay it at the feet of the cross, and we say, God, today I decide to follow you and no other. I know this is weird, guys. I don't usually do this. This is weird. But I'm feeling the Holy Spirit saying, I am coming quickly. I'm coming quickly. Get your lives in order. Get them together. Be ready. If there's something you need to do and put it on the altar, if you need to spend time on your face before God, do it. Do it. Because he's coming back for people who are watching and waiting and ready and who have said, I'm done with the world. I'm done with it. I'm done with my way and I'm doing it your way. That's who he's coming back for. He's coming back for you. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Lord Jesus, we acknowledge your word today. God, make us ready. Make us a people who are ready to follow you in all our ways, to leave the world behind you. Lord, to leave the world behind and follow you.
Amen.
the world behind us, the cross before us.
Amen.
That's where my pursuit is from this day forward. I pursue Jesus. You with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. I will love you, and I will love the people you tell me to love.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
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 You may be seated if you can. Praise God.
All right. I think we're going to go ahead and dismiss our Kid Venture and Children's Ministry. Our regular children's ministry person has Kimberly. She is tested positive for COVID again, and it kind of goes around like a cold now. And my granddaughter Kaylani also. So they're staying at home. They're not terribly sick. Thank you for your prayers, Kaylani especially, getting it for the first time. But anyway, they're doing the appropriate thing and staying home. And so April and Michelle are stepping in for John and Kim today and taking your children to children's ministry. So what a great group of kids we have. And thank you for doing that thing. All right. Well, we're going to be getting into the Word. You ready to get into the Word?
Amen.
Well, it seems like so much of what was spoken today, either in song or in deed, was just really leading up to what I want to be preaching on today. And really, it's just amazing how the Holy Spirit does that. It's like He has it all planned out and works all these things together according to His perfect will and timing. Well, we're going to be talking about building a strong church using the five pillars of church growth. You say, what in the world are you talking about? We call it DEWFM, discipleship, evangelism, worship, fellowship, and ministry. If you've been around me very long, you've heard those terms before, and we've talked about them quite a bit. I believe that those five principles are things that are found in the Great Commission and the Great Commandment. And in those things, we find the need for discipleship and evangelism and worship and fellowship and ministry. I want to point out on the screens on the wall over here, the beautiful art that we have over here, says discipleship, the five pillars of church growth, discipleship and evangelism and worship and fellowship and ministry. And those things are taken out of the Great Commission over here. You see, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, and the Great Commandment over on this wall. We also have our 10 core values. These are things we believe, and I teach on in a recurring manner, usually every January, first of the year. Last year, being a COVID year, things were a little different. I had preached it every year for several years, and I chose not to do it last year. But there are some of you who have never heard me teach on these things or preach on these things. And these are foundational to the growth and happiness of our church. And so I'm going to bring them up and preach them again. It's time. And so I want to talk about building a strong church. And if we, let me just read what I got here, because it probably says a little more efficiently than I'm stumbling through. It says, these five pillars of the church are found in the commands of Jesus, in the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. These two we just looked at. The healthy church has all five of these areas in place. So every church that is healthy will find itself doing discipleship well. They'll be doing evangelism. They'll be doing worship. They'll have fellowship in the body, and they'll be ministering to one another in some way. If you're a healthy church, you'll have all of these things occurring in the church. And it's by its very nature, a healthy church cannot help but grow. So anything that's healthy grows. Whenever you're a little baby and you're healthy, you grow into a big baby. And big babies who are healthy grow into little kids. And little kids who are healthy grow into adults. And adults who are healthy grow bigger and bigger and bigger if you don't watch out. And if that doesn't work, I hear your nose grows your whole life. It will get longer and longer, and your ears get bigger and bigger. Just something to look forward to if you're young. And those things, there's always something that anything that is healthy just does continue to grow. Now you're going to be thinking about your nose the whole time now. All right, I don't know what I got going on here with the, okay, well, hopefully that'll work out, because I hate holding the handheld microphone. We'll see if we can work that out. But I want to start with Mark chapter 12, verses 30 and 31. It's the Great Commandment. It says, and you shall love the Lord your God. This is Jesus when he was asked about this. His answer was, you shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment, because they ask him, what's the most important? What's number one, Jesus? What's the most important commandment of all these 690 commandments of the Old Testament? What is the one that's the most important? He said, oh, that's easy.
love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like it. He said, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Well, thanks, Jesus. We didn't ask you for number two. Apparently, Jesus decided that we needed to hear it anyway. Apparently, Jesus decided that loving the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength goes hand in hand with loving your neighbor as yourself. And those two things together, he says, the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no greater commandment than these. So he put the two of them together and made it the most important things we need to do. And then before he left this earth, after having fully trained his disciples, he gives them the great commission. As in Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20, it says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. Go and make disciples of all the nations. How many nations are there on earth? I think there's like 220 countries but how many nationalities? How many people groups? Go into all the world. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You saw that this morning. Teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you. So he says, don't just evangelize them and give them the gospel, but also teach them, help them grow, disciple them along the way. He says, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. And so we have these up here, the great commandment, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and then love your neighbor as yourself. Over here, we have the Great Commission, actually in four different Gospels, written four different ways that are very similar. First of all, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations. As the Father has sent me, Jesus said, I also send you. And it says, you shall be witnesses to me to the end of the earth. So in four different ways, he told his church to go out and do this Great Commission. Between these two, the Great Commission and the Great Commandment, they are the source material, they're the foundation for everything the church does. And if you study it close enough, what you'll come up with is these five principles of discipleship, evangelism, worship, fellowship, and ministry. They're all taken out of those different parts of the Great Commandment or the Great Commission. So let me say this, a healthy church will grow deeper through discipleship. It'll grow deeper through discipleship. Jesus said in one of those, he said, teaching them to obey all things I've commanded you. So God wants us to grow deeper. I am amazed at two things. One is at the faithfulness of people who will come every Sunday, even on a rainy Sunday morning like you did today. And you'll brave the elements and you'll come because you love the Lord and you want to grow and you're honoring him by being here and so forth. And the other thing that amazes me is how we human beings, even those that are faithful to church, sometimes can get so blasé about the idea of really walking deeper with God. About how we hear all the words, but it becomes blah, 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 preachers preaching again. And how it is that the Lord desires so much to find you alone with him on your time with him. Times where you would cry out to God. First, you give him your list, you know, the list of everything you want and need him to do. You pray about all those things, and he hears you. And some of those things are very important. Give us this day our daily bread. Help someone get better from their cancer or whatever. The things, the list that we give him are good and right. There's nothing wrong with a prayer list. But there comes a time when there's nothing left to say. And what do you say? The Lord wants you to grow deeper in him. He wants you to know more about him. You may find it in a devotional that you'll read where somebody else has already gone deeper with God. And they have found some deep things and they've regurgitated it back and spit it up and give it to you. You know, like a cow. You know, a cow eats something and spit it back up, you know, and eat it again and contemplate it. You know, or I know these are yummy things to think about, aren't they? I can see your look on your face, but a mama bird that'll eat something and then, you know, regurgitate it back for the babies, right? I mean, that's good. The babies grow. But isn't it good whenever the babies can grow to the point where they get their own food? Isn't it good whenever we begin to move past the devotional to make our devotional time something that's just us and God? Now, most of the time, it's going to be associated with something. It's going to be associated with your Bible. You're going to read something, maybe out of a devotional, maybe out of the Word itself, and it's going to show you something where God's talking to you. And the heart that cries out and says, Lord, talk to me. Lord, show me more. Thank you for showing me my need of salvation. Thank you for showing me my need to be baptized and to be kind and, you know, tithe and bless and show up to church and all those kind of things. But Lord, take me deeper. Take me deeper to a place where I just rejoice in you, where I can't wait to be back in your presence again. Lord, give me a hunger and a thirst for righteousness. If you want to borrow that prayer, then you use that one. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness. You don't automatically hunger and thirst after righteousness. I don't. You don't either. It's something that has to be cultivated. It's something that is an answer to prayer, because you are a bag of meat, and so am I. We're a bag of emotions and chemicals and brain thinking that is all screwed up at times. But there is also a spiritual part of you that separates you from your dog. Yeah. And if your dog knows how to adore you, don't you think you can adore God a little better yourself? Man, how many people have dogs? Man, if you don't hate your dog, you probably love your dog. And you know your dog worships and adores you. You come into the house and it's been late, light comes on. The dog's been wandering in darkness, but you bring the light. You are the master of transportation. You are the master of security. You are that which masters and supplies all needs, medical and food and exercise. You are the source of all good things to that dog. How much more the Heavenly Father to us? Is there a way that we can look at God like our dog looks at us sometimes? You know, the cat thinks he owns a place. The dog somehow thinks you're God. Cat thinks he's God. But really, there's only one God. And all of us need to come to God and look for ways to adore him. I hope that's a challenge to you. I hope that in the privacy of your own thoughts, not when your wife's like, you know, I've been telling you this for a week, you know, or you don't, I hope we don't remind each other of this. And I hope is that the Holy Spirit knocks on your heart's door and says, I want to come in and fellowship with you. Like Revelation 3:20 says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and sup with him, have dinner. We're going to hang out. It's like April was preaching my message this morning. She says, it's time to hang out and look across the table. Actually, she wasn't saying to you. I heard, she was saying it to the praise team this morning during a devotional moment. God wants to have dinner with you. He wants to look at you across the table. He wants to say, how'd your day go? He wants to know that, wants you to know that he cares. He wants you to care about what he cares about. And my prayer to him is, Lord, help me to care about the things that you care about. Help me to see the world the way you see. He wants us to grow deeper through discipleship. So your Bible's going to be nearby. Your coffee is probably going to be nearby too. That's just extra. I'm not sure that's in the Bible anywhere, but I'm sure a coffee is necessary in the morning for a devotional time with God. I don't know. It's in the Hebrew deep somewhere in the Hebrews, right? Dun-dun-dun. 2 Timothy 2, chapter 2, verses 3 through 5 says, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. And if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. I see this thing of entangling yourself with the affairs of life. If we want to be a good soldier of Jesus Christ, there's a discipline that goes there. There are young men all over this country and young women too who will join up into the military and they'll go for the hard jobs. They won't do something easy like the Army. I was in the Air Force, so I can, you know, pick on the Army. No, they want to go do the Marines or something. They want to go do something hard. They want to go do something that's challenging. And if it's and it's amazing how people are willing to do that. And yet, is there a place that we could be that with God? Can we consider that maybe the value we find in our life from doing something significant could be that which we do significant for God instead of significant for Uncle Sam? Could it be that we would decide that maybe the most significant and the most powerful, the most overcoming things we do could be something for God? That's why he says, we must endure hardship as a good soldier, Jesus Christ. No one entangled in the warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life. How much the affairs of this life stop us from doing what he wants? Well, you know, you got to keep working that second job so you can make that car payment. Do you really need the second car? Do you need the we convince ourselves that we need so much more than we can do without. I want to be socially involved. I've got kids in Little League, and I've got, others in dance, and I've got others doing gymnastics and others in soccer. And there's so many things that we can get involved in, and they're all good things. But how easy it is to overwhelm our life with busyness. Both the ones that are necessary, like your job, and the things that really aren't necessary. And we have no time left to really grow in God or serve. We got to be careful not to entangle ourselves with the affairs of the life of this life. Why? So that we may please him who enlisted us as a soldier. Verse 5, also, if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. Teams who win, are usually those who have the least penalties. Watch the playoff. The playoffs are on, I think it was Oakland that was losing a game last night, but it was a good fight for a while. But ultimately, it came down to turnovers, and it came down to penalties and losses of yards and things like that. And if you don't follow football, then you're like, okay, whatever. But the point is, you have to obey the rules if you're going to do well. That's what Paul's saying here. He says, if you're going to compete in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. How do you know what the rules are? How do you keep, in the rule book. How do you know what's in the rule book? Well, you have to read the thing. You got to pull out and look. And most importantly, you have to be willing to go with the referee's call. We've had these discussions at our house plenty of times watching football about what's right and so forth. But our referee is the Holy Spirit of God. The rule book is the Word of God. And whatever it says is the law. You get to decide whether or not you will want to obey it. But if you don't obey things according to the law, you get ejected from the game or you get penalized. And so it is in our lives that we find so many ways to do, like we want to play in the game of God and we want to do what he wants us to do, but we also want to do what we want to do. And we make infractions, and we hit somebody just a little too hard, roughing the passer, or we cheat and grab something we shouldn't, and hang on to it, and we get a holding penalty, or whatever. It's just there's innumerable ways that while we're doing what God wants us to do, that we want to cheat, we want to help, we want to do it our way, and God's like, if you just stay in the rule book. The fewer penalties you have, the better off your life's going to be. I think that's a message to somebody, maybe all of us. Why is it that God was so interested in us not sinning? Well, first of all, because the penalty of sin is hell and death. But even if you have had that cured by the gospel blood of Jesus Christ washing away your sins, it's still possible to be so sidetracked by every other thing that we can get involved in. Soldiers who win are fixated on the mission. They don't entangle themselves with affairs of life. Teams who win are usually have the least penalties in the game. Luke chapter 6 and verse 40, it says, a disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is perfectly trained will be like his teacher. So that's the goal, is to look like Jesus. That's a pretty high, lofty goal, isn't it? I mean, who could say, I'm like Jesus, you know? Look at, I am like Christ. Well, first of all, you're probably in danger of being arrogant if you're saying that. You're not maybe aware of how much we fail. But the tendency then becomes that I won't even try. After all, we're all sinners, right? So don't blame me, you know. I'm just a sinner like the rest of us. That's just me. You're going to have to put up with me. There's a whole lot of me in those statements. A whole lot of me in there. And God wants us to be more like him. He says, a disciple is not above his teacher. But everyone who is perfectly trained will be just like his teacher. God wants you to be just like Jesus Christ. God wants you to be just like Jesus Christ. So if you're patting yourself on the back and you're thinking you're doing pretty good because you quit beating your wife, or you think you're doing pretty good because you quit cussing and swearing and cheating and robbing banks or whatever, if you think you're doing pretty good because you're just a good citizen, don't stop there. The challenge is to be just like Christ. And so no matter how good you get, there's always opportunity for growth. It doesn't mean you should always feel bad about yourself because you're never perfect like Jesus is. Give yourself a break if that's the extreme you've gone to. But it's too easy to slide to the other extreme and say, nobody's perfect, so why try? The Lord wants us to try to become, to be more like Christ. Be a disciple. Be under discipline. So we need to grow deeper through discipleship. Discipleship really is going to be getting that word in you, that teaching in you, and then under discipline, becoming more and more like him. Secondly, he wants us to grow larger through evangelism. He wants the church under here. So we've talked about discipleship. Let's talk about evangelism. He wants us to grow larger through evangelism. If your only experience with the word evangelism is TV evangelist, you have no idea then what I'm talking about then. Evangelism comes from is to go share the good news with someone, to actively be involved in trying to bring them in to the faith, to share the good news of Jesus with someone else. That's what evangelism is. All right, so he wants us to grow larger, the church grow larger through evangelism. That comes from the Great Commission where he said, go and make disciples. Go make disciples of all the nations. And so the go part is what we have to do. We got to go get them. Have you noticed that of the 39 or 40,000 people in Titusville city limits that most of them aren't here today? Have you noticed? Right. Why is that? Is it because they hate us? No. Most likely they don't know we exist. Or if they do know we exist, they don't think about us. Why is that? Because we haven't knocked on their door and invited them. Or put out an advertisement, in some way invited someone to be here. He says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He didn't say, sit on your laurels at home and put up a shingle. Just said, hey, if anybody wants to be saved, just find your way in here. I hope you find us. We're one of 10,000 distractions. And I hope, no, Jesus wants us to be aggressive and go and tell them. You say, well, I don't do aggressive. Well, okay. You just tell that to Jesus, all right? Just tell him you don't do aggressive. And what do you think he's going to say? I think he's going to gently and lovingly tell you that there's something that you can do. That maybe we should quit telling him what we can't do and what we don't do and find what it is we can do. If you can't knock on doors and tell people cold calls and tell them about Jesus, can you hand somebody one of our cards that has the ABCs of salvation? Can you point that out to them? Can you just simply share your own faith and what Jesus did in your own life and say, hey, man, Jesus is a better way to do life? Can you just simply invite someone to church and come and hear the gospel here? We can do something. So he wants us to grow larger through evangelism. Luke chapter 16, verses 23 to 24 says, the story about the rich man and Lazarus in hell. It says, and being in torments in Hades or hell, I don't know why they put the word Hades there. That's actually the correct Greek word for Hades, but we're not Greek. We're English people, and we have an English Bible, and we understand hell with the word hell. What is the word Hades? It's literally the Greek word for hell. They're interchangeable. So where you see Hades there, you can put the word hell. So being in torments in hell, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And then he cried out and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. That's a real story. Jesus told it as a real story. Some might try to say it's just a story, it's just an allegory. But it's not. He told it as if it was just straight up, this is a story, let me tell you what happened. There is a hell. There's plenty of places. I'm not preaching on hell today, but there's plenty of places to find that there is a real hell to shun, to stay away from, and a real heaven to go to. Everybody wants to believe in heaven. Nobody wants to believe in hell. Sorry, they go together. It's all in the book. It really doesn't matter whether you believe in heaven or hell. What matters is, do you believe the Word of God? If the Word of God is true, then everything in it is true. And heaven is real because we know it in the Word. And hell is real because we know about it in the Word. And so we understand that people who don't get saved are headed for hell. Not a great thing to think about. Maybe not the first thing you want to start with when you go try to evangelize. But it is the reason for our evangelism. Being in torments in hell. He was so tormented for so long and so thirsty, which I think has got to be the worst part of hell. Because if you've ever been really, really thirsty and unable to quench that thirst, you're really like, yeah, that's one of the most miserable things you can be. So much that not, hey, can you get me a Gatorade? You know? I mean, it wasn't like, hey, can you get me a whole quart full of water? Can you get me, you know, can you pipe in some water here? It's really hot over here, really thirsty over here. Can you do something about our thirst and really quench it? He thought that was unrealistic, and it was. But in a desperate plea, he thought, maybe if I could do something so extreme as to just get one drop of water. You could see he'd been thinking about this. You could see he'd been thinking about, man, if I could just one drop of water in my tongue, how wonderful that would feel, how good and how quenching, just to undry out my tongue for one moment. Maybe I could swallow without my voice sticking together for one time. But he says, I'm tormented in this flame. Could you just do this one thing? Of course, the answer was basically, no, we can't. There's a gulf fixed between you and I, and I can't do anything about it. And I'm very sorry, but you're stuck. There's no happy ending to that parable. I wish I could tell you there was, but there's not. In Revelation chapter 20 and verse 15, God is judging the world, and he's looking in the books and judging people out of the books. And the most important judgment is to judge whether or not a person has been saved or not, has ever been given their heart to Jesus or not. And if you have, your name is written in the book of life. And if you've never given your heart to Jesus, then your name is not written in the book of life. And so in Revelation 20 and verse 15, it says, and anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Now, you might get real egghead educated and start talking about, well, how many people have my same name, first and last? I don't know. I mean, it didn't seem to bother the government. They figured out a way to give you a number, too. So now we know which one you are. Does God use a numbering system? I don't know. He invented math. You think this is a problem for God? Maybe calls you by a completely different name than you were given. Probably will. But I know one thing. He knows your name. And he says, if anyone is not found written in the book of life, they were cast into the lake of fire. Again, not a message on hell today necessarily, but hell's like going to jail. The lake of fire is like going to prison. It's the final place, out of the frying pan and into the fire, so to speak. Anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. There is a reason why we evangelize. Good news. Give me some good news. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Everlasting life. Everlasting life in heaven is good. Everlasting death in hell is bad. And it is an everlasting death, meaning you're alive to be dead. What does that mean? How can you be both? The Bible says that in Revelation 21:8, the fearful, the unbelieving, the abominable, the sorcerers, the idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. See, the first death is when you die. The second death is when you are eternally separated from God. And that goes on and on forever. And it's something to be avoided. Good news. There's a way. Jesus. All you have to do is put your faith and belief in Jesus Christ, and you can have eternal life. Luke chapter 14, verse 23 says, "The master said to the servant, go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in that my house may be filled." That may be the very best verse I've ever seen to tell a church we need to fill these chairs. We need to fill these chairs. Well, what happens when we get them full? There's 50 more right there. Look, see? There's a bunch more right there behind you and over there. There's another 50 we can put out. What happens when we fill those up? I don't know. Let's find out. Wouldn't that be a good problem to have? You know, is Jesus all about numbers? Is he about quantity or is he about quality? Yeah. How do you answer that? I do know he's concerned about numbers, though. He wrote a whole book called Numbers. Not just trying to be cute. The master said to the servant, go out into the highways and hedges. Go. Go. When I told my dog, get, she understands what that means. It means start moving in some direction. Get. He's saying to us, go, not get out of his presence, but to go out into the highways and hedges. Highways is the big open areas, and the hedges, hedgerows, is the back alleys and whatever. But go wherever it takes and compel them to come in that my house may be filled. Great need requires great effort. There is a great need of lost people in our town, and God wants us to compel them to come in. That means we have to go out where they are and do that. You can do that on Saturday, not this Saturday, but the following Saturday, whenever we go to Kate's neighborhood and compel them to come in by putting door hangers on their doors. Or you can do it by your own personal witness and inviting people to come. Or maybe we can go down to Rock Pit Road where there were another couple of murders one Sunday ago. Sunday afternoon a week ago, there were two more murders on Rock Pit Road. It's the hood. Everybody knows it's the hood. I'm not down talking them. It's just that there are places in this city, even in Mims, another murder yesterday, two guys shot each other, that desperately need the gospel.
Yes.
They're not coming in here. They're wanting to know if some way can we reach out there, compel them to come in that my house may be filled. The choice is not whether or not to act, but really, how do we act? How do we do it? I don't know. I threw out a couple of ideas already. Maybe come up with some better ones. We're going to get the shepherds and staff today and just going to meet today and talk about these very things. How do we do this better? But the question is not whether or not we do it. The question is, how do we do it? Because he commanded it, and we need to do it. There's a compelling reason to evangelize. The need is great. And number three in this discipleship, evangelism, worship, fellowship, and ministry, the third one is worship. God wants our church to grow stronger through worship. April did a great job worshiping, leading in worship, and even talking about reasons for worship today. He wants us to grow stronger through worshiping him. A part of that from the great commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart. Love the Lord with all your heart. Not always the easiest thing to think of, but let me show you a good example here in Psalms. First Chronicles. First Chronicles chapter 16, verses 29 through 36. It's really written like a psalm. But it says, verse 29 says, "Give to the Lord the glory that is due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. The world also is firmly established. It shall not be moved. Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad, and let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Let the sea roar in all its fullness. Let the field rejoice and all that is in it. Then the trees of the woods shall rejoice before the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. And say, save us, O God, our salvation. Gather us together and deliver us from the Gentiles, to give thanks to your holy name, to triumph in your praise. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting to everlasting. Could you say it better? Did a good job, didn't he? But let me show you a couple of things to look in this. First of all, so worship has an object. If you're trying to understand exactly what is worship, worship is something that has an object. And God is that object. So when we come to worship, if you're not here for God, then you've got the wrong motivation. You come to see me, that's good, because I want to be your friend and your buddy. You come here because we have coffee, well, I hope you know, it is free and you can have something, you know. If you come because, I don't know why people come. I know one thing, your motive to come here should be to worship God. There's an object of our worship. Give to the Lord glory to his name. Bring an offering, come before him. There's another place in here. Where did I see that? Let the heavens rejoice, the earth be glad. These are all reactions to it. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel. Give thanks to your holy name. Triumph in your praise. See, the heart of worship is acknowledging him as Lord. The lordship of God. The lordship of God means he's in charge and you're not. You see, you can't worship something without making it in charge of you. That's why he encourages not to worship anything but God himself. When people worship anything else, another person, or money, or success, or whatever, then you make that person or that thing in charge of you. And it's easy when we worship sin to make it the Lord of us. You see, it becomes the object of our worship. You see, all worship has to have an object, and then once we have an object of our worship, then we do things that show our devotion. Notice again where it says, think about that when it says here, give to the Lord, there's the object, the glory due his name. So he wants us to give glory. Bring an offering. So an offering is part of our worship to him. Come before him. That means show up to church. Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Do a good job. Tremble before him, all the earth. Take it seriously. The world also is firmly established. It shall not be moved. Let the heavens rejoice and let the earth be glad. And let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The Lord reigns and rules over us. That's the heart of worship, is acknowledging that he is the object of that worship. And his lordship over us is the very nature of worship. You're not worshiping if you're not obeying. If you're not doing what God wants you to do, then you're not really worshiping. You're just giving lip service. Because when we acknowledge the Lord, when we say he is the Lord, when we say the Lord reigns or rules over us, then we find that we bring our offering, that we bring our praise, that we bring our worship, that we bring all the things of that he wants us to bring. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, his mercy endures forever. And say, save us, O God, our salvation. Gather us together and deliver us from the Gentiles to give thanks to your holy name, to triumph in your praise. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting to everlasting. The heart of worship is acknowledging the lordship of God, and the result of worship is giving. Giving praise, giving money, giving time, giving our affection, giving something. So if you want to know how we can grow stronger through worship, then you need to worship God. You need to realize that He is Lord. He reigns over your life. And the sooner you do that, the sooner you will begin to engage in worship. Maybe when you look at other people and you see how they're just engaged in worship, maybe somebody like April, I'll pick up my wife, who just knows how to really get into worship. You know, if she could possibly get it, she could. If she could get down off of that keyboard, she's probably down here kneeling and crying at the altar and making a big mess, you know, snotting and stuff, you know, and just really worshiping and praising God. And you go, wow, I want to worship like that. I wonder what that's like. What does it feel like to worship God so much that it brings you to tears? What is that even like? You won't know until you obey. Because He has to be Lord first. And once He becomes Lord of your life, that means He's in charge of your life. And what He says goes, and what you want stops. And from that position of worship, then you bring praise to Him. You bring offerings to Him. You bring yourself to Him. You bring yourself to an altar. You stand there, worship and praise. You bring tears of joy and gladness. You bring whatever you bring, but it's only a reaction to the person who has made Him not just their Savior, but their Lord as well. I encourage you to grow in your strength of your faith by learning to worship. And that starts with, He is worthy. And you are not. And I am not. He is. It says in the next passage here in Luke chapter 10, verses 38 to 42. It says, now it happened as they went that He entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed Him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard His word. Where was Martha? Where was Mary? At Jesus' feet, hearing His word. Where was Martha? Verse 40 says, but Martha was distracted. Everybody say distracted. She was distracted with much serving. Is serving Jesus a good thing? Absolutely. But too much of a good thing in this case for Martha, because serving became distracting from that which is even better, which was worship. I want you to serve Jesus with your whole life, but you won't until you first worship. She was distracted with much serving, and she approached Him and said, Lord, You do not care that my sister has left me alone to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me. And Jesus answered her and said, no. Well, He didn't say that specifically. He said, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. Moral of the story is, don't miss out on your opportunity to worship God. There are opportunities to worship every Sunday morning here. That's why we have the praise and worship portion. Worship doesn't necessarily mean music, but it very often is. There is a whole book in the Bible called the Psalms. It's 150 chapters of singing praises and worship to God. It's the reason why it's the bulk and majority of the worship that we have here. God gave you a voice. He wants to hear you sing back to Him. Maybe your neighbor don't, but He does. We make a joyful noise unto the Lord. That's fine. Worship and praise Him, the fruit of your lips. Don't miss out on your opportunity to worship God. Worshiping together is more important than serving together. Think about that. Coming together here on Sunday morning or whenever we meet and worshiping together corporately, you should be already worshiping on your own, in your own devotional time. But worshiping together is more important than serving together. That's what I get from this. Is that what you get? Jesus said, I'm not going to tell her to come help you. I'm going to tell you to go sit with her at my feet and do the right thing. Do the better thing. Serving is good, but worship is better. Worshiping together is more important than serving together. Worship will lead to service, but service will never lead to worship. Think about that. Am I right? I thought about it. I thought, well, it sounds cute, but maybe I'm wrong. You see, service will never lead to worship. You can get in this church and you can serve and you can serve. I have known of people who no longer come here, who were great servants, who serve and serve and serve and serve. And when they notice that Martha or Mary isn't helping, there becomes this entitlement issue that says, what gives? The answer isn't to make everyone else help serve, but rather let's start with worship. Because more and more serving will not lead you to worship. More and more serving will lead you to burnout. How do you avoid burnout? By refilling your soul, by restoring your soul. Psalm 23 leads you beside the still waters and restores your soul. Where does that happen? It happens in worship. Doesn't it happen in working more, doing more? It comes by worshiping Him. I challenge you, I implore you to figure out what worship means and then go do it. And let Martha and Mary be an example to us as to how to do it. Worship will lead to service, but service will never lead to worship. He wants us, number four, to grow warmer through fellowship. Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 46 says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and the breaking of bread. Oh, fellowship. See that? That's that fellowship part. We're going to grow warmer through fellowship. In breaking of bread, I love that. I wonder if there's butter on it. And in prayers. Verse 46 goes on to say, so continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart. There are those who would say this is communion that they're talking about, the bread of the Lord's table. The best we can tell, they were having love feasts of food and hangout time and suppering with each other, and also adding at the end the communion meal with the bread and the wine that was left. But they were having hangout time with food. And those of you who are in this shepherd and staff meeting, we're going to have food afterwards for you to enjoy while we plan the calendar for the year. Why? Because there's warmth in fellowship. Baptism initiates you into the body of Christ and a fellowship of believers. So you saw baptism today. Somebody's baptized into the body of Christ. And so we're warm through fellowship. But the Lord's Supper or communion demonstrates the unity of the body. Ephesians 2:19 says, now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. It says you've been initiated, you've been baptized, you're in here, you're now in the body. Thank you. Amen. But now he wants us to grow warmer by taking each other to dinner, hello, or surrounding a meal or getting a cup of coffee together or spending the warmth of fellowship. We need each other. We need to fellowship with one another. We need to know each other's names, their kids' names if possible, what people do for work, whatever we can find out. We need to expand ever more the fellowship in our church. It is necessary. We're a family. We need to act like a family. We need to know one another. We need to see one another. We need to invite one another. It's not all about the food. It's just that it just so naturally happens around food. The Bible says a lot about eating. Now I've got to move on because I need to finish this, but it says that also we're going to grow broader through ministry. Ministry is the last one on the chart there. Matthew 25 and verse 40. By the way, this comes from the great commandment that we would love our neighbor as ourself. Well, love is a verb, and we love one another by doing something for someone else. Matthew 25, 40 says, and the king will answer and say to them, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Jesus was talking about judgment in the last days, and he was saying, whenever it's all added up and judged, it's going to be like, whatever you did for you, Whatever you did for her and whatever she did for her and him and her and whatever we do for one another, he says, as you do it unto the body of Christ, you have literally done it unto me, Jesus says. So if you want to minister to Jesus, if you want to learn what ministry it's about, then it's about meeting the needs of one another. Somebody needs prayer. Somebody needs a tire plugged. Somebody needs some discipleship. Somebody needs good counsel. Somebody needs just an ear to hear. Somebody doesn't need your advice, maybe. Somebody just needs somebody to be there for somebody. And so we need to be there for one another. And then finally, last verse here I want to bring you to is Ephesians 4:16. Talks about Jesus, from whom the whole body, that's the body of Christ, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effect of working, by which every part does its share. That's the key line I want you to think about. Every part does its share, and it causes growth of the body. Causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. God wants us to minister to one another. God wants us to cause our body to grow by ministering to one another. Nothing will make a church shallower than having a whole lot of people who don't know each other. That's called an audience. It's a room full of people gathered to watch a show who don't know each other. But this is not an audience. This is the church. And the church ministers to one another. We do things for one another. We look out for one another. We share whatever is necessary with one another so that nobody goes hungry or broke or without care or lonely or whatever the need is. We look out for one another. And that's what makes us a body instead of an audience. God wants us to be the body of Christ, not an audience on Sunday morning. So, that's all I got. I'm going to let you out of here in just a moment. And children's ministry is like, is he done yet? Is he done yet? Yes, I'm done, Michelle. You can bring him in if you want. I'm going to give the blessing in just a moment. But what is the appropriate response to this? Well, part of that response is going to happen with the team today that's going to meet to plan our calendar this year. We're going to say, Lord, how do we expand in evangelism to our community? How do we teach our body better in discipleship? How do we foster better worship in our services? How do we plan events that will cause our people to be able to naturally fellowship with one another better? And how do we train our people to get active in their gifts and minister to one another in whatever their giftings are? That's what our prayer is going to be. It's what your prayer needs to be as well. Heavenly Father, I pray that the word of God today, Lord, this good teaching of the discipleship, the five pillars of church growth, Lord, would result in a healthy church for Rockettown Church. And I pray, Lord, that we would be doing well in all of these areas, Lord, and that you would help us, Lord, in so doing, to grow, not only grow in depth, but also in size. Lord, that you would bring more and more people into the kingdom and that all those would learn to be trained up to be disciples that are just like Jesus. If there's any needs to be met along the way, we would minister to one another. That you would we would fellowship with one another. That you would bless and worship you, Lord, and find our souls refreshed in worship, Lord. We would minister as you see fit. Thank you, Lord, for working these things in our lives, in our daily lives, our corporate lives together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Stand, if you will, for the blessing. I'll bless you out of here. Again, if you're in shepherd and staff, please stay and go. And if you're in that, you know who you are. If you're a department head, a head of a major ministry, or if you're on the official board, then we'd like for you to stay and have that meal and planning for the future. Let me say this before I let you go. If you're here and you're not on shepherds and staff, you're not a ministry head of anything, and you're not on the official board, but you would like to see how you, if you'd like to come, you're welcome. You're invited to come. If you just want to say, I want to be part of our growth, if I have ideas, I'm excited about it, I want to be part of it, then you are welcome to come as well. It is not a closed door meeting. So if you'd like to do that, we'll, let's see, who wants to give up their pizza and salad? Somebody, she'll give up hers. Do I have another hand? I see one back here. I don't think that counts. But anyway, no, you're welcome. There's plenty there. So may just bless you out of here. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and that bring you peace. For you are blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. You're blessed when you come and when you go. And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear? For who is like the Lord?
Nobody.
Go in his peace today. God bless.